Good morning. The Prince George's County Planning Board is now in session. We have before us a couple of things before we have full commission. First of all, we have the draft minutes of the Planning Board meeting of March 15th and April 5th, 2018. Is there a motion to approve?
Move approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. I was going to take the legislation. I don't think we have enough time for that anymore. So we have a resolution. We have two resolutions. One for Darilyn Marinelli, who has been with us for 32 years. She's been extremely innovative working with our seniors, and particularly ages 60 and better, 60 and better, doing our Club 300 walk for 60 and better, and focusing on the Changing the Way We Age program, Active Aging Week, the senior dance party, the amazing seniors on stage, which is where those 60 and better perform and sing for us, and they are immensely talented. So if we could approve this resolution for Darilyn Marinelli, it'd be greatly appreciated.
Move approval. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. I meant to say she's retiring after 32 years. Okay. And we also have a resolution of appreciation for James Obrenovich, who has also served with the Park and Planning Commission for over 32 years, and particularly with the Prince George's County Park Police Equestrian Mounted Units. He's won numerous awards, the Kitty Hawk Civilian of the Year Award. He's gotten many medals and initiated a number of special projects to benefit the Park Police Mounted Division. And he, too, he retired from the commission and the Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission, and in 2018, but subsequently passed away. He's sorely missed by his colleagues and his beloved horses. So we need this resolution of appreciation, please. Approved. Thank you.
Move. Second.
A motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Okay. So,
Okay, the Prince George's County Planning Board is also joining.
So the Planning Board is in session, but we are now meeting as the full commission with our Montgomery County Planning Board as well via telephone conference. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, colleagues.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So do we need a briefing on this, or can we just get a motion? I got Bill Spencer here. You want to say anything, Bill?
Not really. I think there was, as I was explaining earlier, there was one issue that we was expressed at the full commission last time regarding the secondary employment and the need for insurance, comprehensive insurance policy that has been addressed, and it appeared a little onerous previously, so we made it less, and so that folks engaging in secondary employment on the side, you know, just doing home repair or whatever on their own, would not have to go through that entire process as originally proposed. But other than that, everything remains as it was during the last time that you all saw the package. So that's it.
If I could.
Okay. Could we, if there are no questions or comments, could we get a motion to approve Resolution 1808?
Casey.
Patty Barney is here and trying to say something.
If you could, just for the record, because we haven't been in open session, I just, Patty Barney, Executive Director, want to make just a very few comments for the record, because we have not been, as a commission, in open session discussing the collective bargaining agreement in a public session. So just very briefly, we did present the collective bargaining agreement in closed session, so we will not be discussing that. We were waiting for the McGeo collective bargaining agreement, the tentative agreement that we had reached, to be ratified by the McGeo employees. They have ratified that agreement, and I just, for the record, want to note the few highlights related to our compensation. And I'll be very fast. fast. You know, I speak very quickly, Mr. Chair. So just quickly, for those employees who are listening, we will be having a merit step just in FY19. We have a one-year agreement for our compensation. We will have reopeners for FY20 and FY21. We'll have to reopen it, based on economic conditions. We had some uncertainty there. We did, for FY19, approve a 1.5% COLA. It will be effective the first pay period after October 1. We will have lump sums, 0.5%, for those employees at top of grade for all 3 years. And of note, we did also include an additional use of our reserves in our group insurance fund once they exceed the 10%, which they have, to provide what we call premium holidays. And we will bring in that resolution for the actual number of holidays to provide some relief to our employees and also provide resources to our employer from those excess reserves in the group insurance fund at the next commission meeting. So again, with that, we thank the folks who are listening. We thank the management team for their work. And I would ask for the commission to ratify the collective bargaining agreement before them. Thank you very much.
Okay, can we get a motion to approve the agreement?
So moved.
We have a motion by Natalie Fanning Gonzalez and a second by somebody in Prince George's County who I didn't identify.
Hewlett.
Okay, Ms. Hewlett, thank you.
Thank you.
Can we, if there's no further discussion, all in favor, aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That passes unanimously. And we've got everybody here on this side except for Norman Dreyfus.
And we have.
And I take it you've got everybody over there except for Commissioner Geraldo.
Commissioner Geraldo's not here. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, very good. Thank you all.
Thank you very
much.
Thank
you.
Bye-bye.
Take care.
Thank you. Zimmerman is now exiting.
Patty.
Okay. Just give that back
to you. The speaker. Oh, okay, got it.
Oh,
okay. 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 We have a couple of minutes. Ms. Borden, we have legislation for CB10 and CB11 2018.
Yes, Madam Chair, Deborah Borden, Principal Counsel. I am presenting CB 11 and CB 10. CB 10 is the zoning bill entitled Tourist Homes.
Oh, I'm sorry. We're coming out of full commission, and we're now back in the Prince George's County Planning Board. Thank you very much. Okay, Ms.
Borden. I should have reminded you.
Okay.
Thank you. So CB 10 and CB 11. CB 10 is the zoning bill. It's entitled Tourist Homes as Accessory Uses. And it is intended to place the short-term rental use into the zoning ordinance as an accessory use to a dwelling unit using an existing use that's already in our zoning ordinance. A version of this bill came before you, and this would be draft 2, and we were asked by the county attorney to help fix the issues that were raised with the bill. There were issues raised by the planning board, issues raised by the council to the county council. And so we have attempted to address those issues by using tourist home. The reason we chose that is because tourist home is one of the definitions that is included in the hotel tax, and that is what the county executive is interested in. He wants to make sure that these short-term rentals will come under that hotel tax so that the county can start collecting that, as most counties are now collecting that tax on these short-term rentals. So that was the objective here, and we think we've done that. We've had to make a few corrections, alterations. We've made recommendations as to the zones that these should be allowed in, but I just want to emphasize that this is only an accessory use to a dwelling unit. So if you're dealing with an investor type situation, that really wouldn't apply to this use. They would have to come under some other use type. Okay, it's only for people who are living in their homes or they have a full-time, someone who is living in their home, and they can rent out their home through an Airbnb-style platform for up to 90 days per year. But they will have to pay that hotel tax, and that will be handled through the platform itself. Any questions? We included CB 11 as the, which is the licensing bill. There will be a license through the county. We included that because these bills were intended to work together, but the planning board is really only tasked with recommending on the zoning text amendment. And we have included a memo, and we recommend that the planning board support the zoning text amendment.
Are there any questions?
So, are we, in our recommendation, are we only making a recommendation on CB 10 to 2018?
Yes, that's correct. That's what the planning board is tasked with doing, making a recommendation on the zoning bill. We've included it because it needs to match what the licensing bill says, and it does match.
Okay.
But if you have a question about it, we can certainly answer that, because we did redraft it so that it would match the zoning.
No, so I'm fine on the zoning bill on CB 10 2018. I wouldn't approve or wouldn't vote in favor of CB 11 2018 until I had an impact study to show how this is going to impact different rentals, because my concern is that the county council has not done a good job at kind of getting up to speed with new and evolving technologies and uses. Specifically, I'm thinking about food trucks, where they've done actually a very poor job at supporting that type of land use and that type of business. And I'd be concerned that a short-term rental could potentially prohibit homeowners from renting out their home for a weekend or a day or a night if there were a special event that would come up and they didn't have the ability to get the rental agreement, and I just don't think we should be taxing those kinds of uses. But if we're not voting on that, then that's fine. We can vote on the land use zoning bill, CB 10 2018, and I'll just let my comments stand and encourage the county council to do a better job at illustrating how they're going to work with local entrepreneurs and local businesses and local owners, instead of just outright taxing them and not actually responding to any problems that emerge when they do.
So your comments, we appreciate your comments. Is that a motion for 10?
Yeah, I'll make a motion to support 10.
Okay. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. So that's it, Ms. Borden?
That's
okay,
it.
Okay, planning
Thank
board
you.
Is in recess for 4 minutes. Okay, the Prince George's County Planning Board is back in session. We have several announcements. The first, unfortunately, there were a lot of passings the past week, and we didn't meet the first week in May. So I'm going to ask that point out that John Nissel, who is our deputy director for Montgomery Parks, lost his father during the intervening 2 weeks. So we want to remember John Nissel and his family. Judge Kathy Surrett, who is on the circuit court for Prince George's County, lost her mother. We want to remember Judge Surrett. Judge Joseph Dugan, retired circuit court judge, Montgomery County, also lost his mom. And then Judge Pamela Brown, district court judge. And these are all colleagues from Howard County, lost her father quite soon after losing her mother. Luana Hutchins, who worked for Parks and Recreation Department for 32 years, and she was the assistant to the executive director for the director of Parks and Rec for many, many years, starting with, Hugh Roby, Mary Godfrey, and Mary Wells Harley, those directors. She worked for all of them. And she just gave a lot to the commission. We want to remember Luana. And then we want to remember the family and friends of retiree McKinley Mac Wallace, who was the heavy equipment operator for maintenance and development at Randall Farm. He recently passed. And then Jack Russell, who was the program manager at the Central Administrative Services Health and Safety Office. And finally, as you may have heard this morning, at about 2 o'clock this morning, Baltimore County Executive Kevin Kamenetz had a heart attack and passed during the middle of the night. So he was Baltimore County Executive and a Democratic hopeful for governor. He passed early this morning from cardiac arrest. And we also, if there anyone else who suffered a loss, our hearts go out to you. If we could have a moment of silence for all of those who've passed on. Thank you. May is Asian Pacific Islander Heritage Month. We want to acknowledge and remember and thank all of those of Asian American and Pacific Islander heritage. The Planning Department had a wonderful program this past week on Japan, and it was just really fascinating. And we'll be having another one on May 30th. Is that it? That's the date, right? Madam Planning Director, it's May 30th. Okay. So it is Jewish American Heritage Month, and we also want to acknowledge all of those of a Jewish American heritage, right? And I thought you were just standing up, Mr. Taub. Okay. And for the many, many contributions to our nation and to the world. It is also National Military Appreciation Month. We always want to thank our military for keeping us safe, for putting their lives on the line to protect us. It is National Bike Month. Okay, Commissioner Dorner, National Bike Month, because some of us bike and some of us don't. It is National Mental Health Month. It is National Family Month, Family Reunion Month, and Family Wellness Month. And it is also National Smile Month. So please continue to smile. I want to say on this date in 1924, J. Edgar Hoover was appointed as the first director of the FBI, where he remained until his death in 1972. Interesting person. Okay, May 10th, 1940, Winston Churchill was appointed Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. In the area of sports, the Caps finally beat the Pittsburgh Penguins in the playoffs, so now they're off to the next round against the Tampa Bay, so we got to root for the home teams. In the NBA, Cleveland is in the East getting ready to play the Celtics. And in the West, the Houston Rockets are taking on Golden State Warriors. Can you say KD for Kevin Durant? We got to root for our home guy from Seat Pleasant, Prince George's County, right?
Don't forget Quinn Cook.
Oh, that's right. Thank you very, very much. Okay. And I want to say happy birthday to Rob, who is our budget manager in the chairman's office. And so he's shy and retiring, so he's just been busted out. Okay. So congrats to Steve and Diane Proctor. Steve in particular comes to the planning board regularly, but we want to recognize them for being recognized by Bishop McNamara High School for their contributions to the Prince George's County community, so much so that Bishop McNamara has named their leadership center, and it's now called the Steve and Diane Proctor Leadership Center after them. That's pretty profound. Great. So we want to acknowledge them as well. Also in the area of awards, we want to acknowledge our own planning director, Ms. Andre Green Checkley. She is the community award winner from the Women of Prince George's. And that Women of Prince George's honors business and professional women who are making significant contributions to the business community. And this affair will be held next Thursday. She won't be here next Thursday at the Greenbelt Marriott. And it's because of her commitment to educating women in business and the example she has set to other women as she successfully navigated her journey, which is not over yet. So we want to congratulate our own Andre Tuckley. So I think that's it in the area of awards. And then I want to, because we are foodies over here, I just have to say it is National Hamburger Month, National Barbecue Month, and today is National Shrimp Day. So please enjoy.
Where's the shrimp?
Yeah. So, you know, I hope we have lunch today, and you know, maybe it might include some shrimp. Okay, so without further ado, I'm going to take we have a consent agenda, but item 4, is it 4B?
4B,
we're going to remove from the consent agenda and set it in as item 8. So therefore, is there anyone here to oppose the staff's recommendation on item, well, is there a motion to set it in as item 8?
So moved. Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. So is there anyone here to oppose the staff's recommendation on item 4A? Or any board member who wishes to discuss?
Madam Chair, after consideration of the records for number 4A, I move
adoption of the staff findings and approval of the item on the consent agenda in accordance with the recommendation of staff.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Okay. So now we have item 8, which is a resolution, Planning Board Resolution 18-30 for detailed site plan 17048 Capitol Court Phase 1. Okay, Mr. Bishop.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the board. In a letter dated May 3rd, 2018, the representative of the applicant made a request to make some minor revisions to the resolution, and I have passed out an exhibit.
Yeah, we have.
Okay.
So we have an exhibit which will that has minor corrections in it. It's just a clarification. It doesn't, I don't know that it needs to be marked. It doesn't, I don't think so.
Well, if
you can't be, okay, go ahead.
If you're going to accept these, yeah, you'd want to have them marked as an exhibit and instruct staff to incorporate them into okay. the resolution that you approved.
I was just thinking about it. It's incorporating it into a record, post the record, but okay. All right. We'll have this marked and accepted into the record as staff exhibit number 1. Okay. Mr. Bishop, is that it? Where's Ms. Camp? Any comment?
I don't need to.
Okay. So,
I will.
No, that was okay. A good, your first answer was a good one. Okay. So with the staff exhibit number 1, is there a motion to approve the revised resolution dash 1830?
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Item 6, we have a request for a continuance.
Good morning, Chair, members of the board. Item 6 is a departure from parking and loading standards, DPLS 451, and we are asking that it be continued to June 7th.
Okay. Ms. LaRocca?
Thank you, Rocca. Michelle LaRocca with Myers, Rodbell, and Rosenbaum here this morning for the applicant, and we're in full agreement with the request to set this off for a future date.
June 7th.
Yes.
June 7th. Okay.
All right. June 7th.
Okay.
That will work.
Okay. Are there any questions? Was there anyone else here to speak on this matter? Is there a motion to continue?
Move request for continuance to June 7th.
We have a motion.
Second.
And a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Item 7 followed by 5.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning, Chairman Hulich, Vice Chair Bailey, Commissioner Dorner, and Commissioner Washington. For the record, I am Tiffany Williams Jennings, Planner Coordinator in the Special Projects Section, Countywide Planning Division. Today I come before you to brief you on Mandatory Referral 1733F, which is a full mandatory referral for the Chevy Chase Drive Water Transmission Main. Interconnection between WSSC zones HG660A, 495A, and 415A. Before I proceed, I would like to take a moment to introduce Ms. Ling Lee. Ms. Lee is the project manager, and she is with WSSC. She is in the pipeline design division. Thank you, Ms. Lee.
Thank you.
Following the presentation, Ms. Lee will be available to answer any questions that you may have specifically about the project. Water services provided to approximately 100,000 residents and the area of Conterra through HG415A zone. The purpose of the subject project is for WSSC to provide a water main interconnection to bring water to HG415A zone from pressure zones HG660A, HG495A and HG660A in the event of a failure or some type of problem with the water supply from the Patuxent filtration plant in Laurel. WSSC believes that through this project, both the reliability and redundancy of the 415A zone and its dependent zones will be improved. The project is located, as mentioned, within the within Laurel. It's outside of the city. It's about a mile outside of the city. It is in Planning Area 60, and it's also in Councilmatic District 1. The property is zoned EIA. Surrounding the property is EIA, and the property is abutted by land that's zoned I-3 to the northwestern portion. The project site is located along the public road right-of-way, and I'll actually use the mouse to show you. The public road right-of-way, Chevy Chase Drive, sections of Switzer Road and Switzer Lane, and in a easement here that WSSC plans to obtain at 6150 Chevy Chase Drive. Immediately south of the property is CMIT, which is Chesapeake Math IT Public Charter Elementary School. Also office space is located immediately south. To the north, immediately north of the property, this property here is owned by Capital One. Van Ness Square Corporation also is the property here that's immediately north. The property that is to the west of the site here is EBA Engineering. And to the east, this property here is owned by UPS. Further north of the site is the Patuxent water filtration plant. And to the northwest of the site here is the DoubleTree owned by Hilton. And this area right here is a little Exxon gas station. Well, not little, but it's an Exxon gas station. Notification letters were mailed out on March 26 about the property, adjoining property owners, civic associations, as well as the City of Laurel obtained notification about the project. And staff did not receive any inquiries or concerns regarding the property or the project from stakeholder groups notified. The project site, as mentioned, is located along the public road right-of-way of Chevy Chase Drive, sections of Switzer Road and Switzer Lane, and in a private utility easement at 6150 Chevy Chase Drive. The project also includes the installation of 2,145 linear feet of 24 and 16-inch diameter water transmission main interconnection. It includes the installation of flow control valves, plug valves and vaults, isolation valves and vaults, the supervisory control and data acquisition equipment, conduits and appurtenances. Much of the project area is going to be underground. Only a small portion of the project will be above ground. That includes the coverings of the concrete valve vaults, which will cover the concrete slabs that will cover the valve vaults. Also above ground will be the antenna pole, which will stand 15 feet above the ground. And that will be located in the parking lot at 6150 Chevy Chase Drive. The antenna pole will look something similar to what's shown here in this photograph. These images show other antenna poles that WSSC has done work on. This is the current alignment. As mentioned, this is the parking lot at 6150 Chevy Chase Drive. This is the public, the private driveway. WSSC will need an easement in order to have access to this. This is what's mentioned, Chevy Chase Drive here. And this is Switzer Switzer Lane and Switzer Road there. These are other images that gives you a better idea of the area that will have the installation of the 24 and 16 inch water mains. And this here are photographs that show the general area there. Again, this is Chevy Chase Drive, and this is the private driveway at 6150 where the easement will be needed. These are plans, of course, provided by the applicant that shows the various right-of-way needs at 6150 Chevy Chase Drive and then the adjacent property. What permits and requirements will be needed by WSSC? The Natural Resources Inventory Equivalency Letter will be needed, as well as a special utility permit, a water construction permit, and the Woodland Conservation Letter of Exemption. The project schedule, if all goes well and there are no delays due to inclement weather, WSSC foresees the design to be completed in the spring of this year. The construction start will take place in the fall of 2018, and the estimated construction completion will be next year. Anticipated work will take place during the workday, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. This project will be funded by bonds. It has been approved, and it's in the WSSC Capital Improvement Plan, W1202. Staff recommends that this project definitely be coordinated with the adjacent property owners, including the Capital One Bank, Van Ness Square Corporation, UPS, Chesapeake Lighthouse Foundation, and particularly the Chesapeake Math IT Public Charter School. It's important to note that the school hours for CMIT are 7:55 to 2:55 p.m., and the anticipated work schedule is 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. So staff believes that coordination of the project's construction schedule is essential for this project. Are there any questions of me?
Yes. Commissioner Dorner.
This, maybe not for you, maybe for the WSSC person. But I just was wondering what the purpose is of the antenna pole, if it's to regulate or to monitor flow and potential problems, or what purpose it serves, and then whether or not it could be actually put onto like a utility pole as opposed to a separate freestanding antenna pole.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Lee?
Oh, yeah. Actually, it's just a remote control antenna to control the flow valve inside the valve.
The mic.
Yeah.
Okay, please. Okay, two things. First of all, can you raise the microphone to you, and then please identify yourself for the record.
Okay.
Thank
sorry. You. I'm mainly the project manager of WSC Pipeline Design Division.
Thank you.
For the antenna pole, that's for the just a remote control system for the flow control valve inside the valve, and actually it's not as big as the utility pole. It's if you see the picture, that's like a flat pole. Yeah.
Is it possible to attach it closer or onto an actual utility pole instead of having it freestanding?
Probably. Oh, like that. Yeah, maybe we can, but we don't think there's a utility to the parking lot, but we can have a look. Yeah, there's some parking lot tempo. We may consider about it. Yeah.
If you take a look at that, that'd be helpful.
Sure. We will have a look.
Thank you. Are there other questions? Thank you. Anything else to add?
No, I don't have anything.
Thank you. What's the pleasure? Thank you. What's the pleasure of the board?
Madam Chair, do we accept the recommendations of staff and authorize transfer of the report to Ms. Ling Lee with WSSC?
Second. We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so the next case is item 5. And we have a number of people signed up on this matter. Okay, so it is the detailed site plans 17.
for Sacred Heart. Site is screened from the adjacent residential homes with vegetation. believe this is on May 1st.
So that's already in our record, right?
This is not in your record, no. This has to be decided by the board if it is to be part of the record.
I mean, let me just say this. We have it, but it may, it's some citizen opposition. Can I see it for a second, please?
Of course.
And I think, I know one thing, we do not do land use by plebiscite. There's a substantial case law in this matter. So while we can accept legitimate concerns that are raised in this letter, I don't think the sheer number of people signing it just indicating that they're opposed in and of itself is insufficient, because we do not do land use by plebiscite, meaning that just because 100 people said they're opposed to something, that in and of itself is not controlling. If you want to elaborate, Ms. Borden.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Deborah Borden, Principal Counsel. Yes, that is correct, and that is why staff reached out to the person that sent the petition to indicate that while we can take your concerns and put those into the record, we really have to leave that the determination as to whether the petition, whether it has any substantive information embedded in the petition that you can consider. So we thought that it would be appropriate for the chair to make a ruling on that at the hearing, as opposed to staff making any sort of determination like that, because it seemed to be a hybrid of both what came in prior to the hearing.
Okay, well, thank you for that. And as you know, this is an administrative hearing, and the rules of evidence are a tad more relaxed in an administrative hearing, more so than they are in court. And but they have to be relevant. It has to meet the relevance test. And Mr. Tao, have you seen this? I would like to show it to you if you haven't seen it.
Madam Chair, for the record, Larry Tao, attorney for Madam Tao and Gilmore, representing the applicant in this case. If it's the same, I don't know, because I haven't seen it.
Okay, so why don't we let you see it? Because I'm inclined to accept it into the record. But you have the opportunity to raise any objections first.
Madam Chair, I would object to the inclusion of this in the record for the reason stated by Principal Counsel. And the problem is that if it's accepted in the record, regardless of your qualifications, it's still in the record as a representation, at least, of potentially a matter that could tend toward interpretation that this is a matter of plebiscite. My point would be that if anyone who is here in opposition today wishes to make their points with regard to this, they're free to do so, and that's fine.
Okay.
But I really would object, because this is signed by many people. It will be in the record, and we do not know to the extent that these individuals understood what they were signed, saw the problem. We just don't know that. So I would object to the inclusion of this into the record.
Thank you. That's okay. All right, so here's what I'm going to do. If you bear with me for a moment. Okay, so right off the top, I see Ms. Rodriguez is here. Okay, so you're one of the persons who signed this. What I'll do is, we don't do, as I said, and as you heard from counsel, both counsel and this counsel, we are prohibited from making land use decisions by plebiscite. So the mere fact that all these people signed it, I'm going to delete that part of it, but I am going to accept the substance of it into the record, noting Mr. Taub's objection for the record. And as a matter of fact, what I'll do is, Ms. Rodriguez, since you signed it and you're here, we can address it when you come up, okay? Yes. Okay, I got it. But it's it says here, did you not sign, are you, did you sign this?
I did.
Okay. So, all right. So when you come up to speak, you can, I'm going to hold it and you can submit it into the record. Okay. And then I'm going to remove all of the petition, the rest of the petition. Okay.
Madam Chair, if I may, the DSP was evaluated with the requirements of the sector plan, specifically exemption 8B, which requires that the findings be made showing that the expansion of the compatible expansion of the not certified non-conforming use is compatible with the adjacent uses and meets the goals of the sector plan, as discussed on pages 7 and 8 of the staff report. The urban design section recommends that the planning board adopt the findings of this report and approve the detailed site plan, DSP 17053, subject to the conditions found in the staff report. This concludes staff's presentation.
Thank you. Are there any questions of Mr. Bishop at this time? Okay, Mr. Dell.
Thank you again, Madam Chair. Just simply obviously put them out on the streets, obviously.
there's a certificate of need.
Actually, the license is current license for 102 beds.
Okay, so we want that marked and accepted into the record as applicant's exhibit number one.
Correct.
And then the certificate of need will be marked and accepted into the record as applicant's exhibit number two.
Appreciate that.
All right, hold on a second.
Sure.
Okay, and then, so you're explaining that there will be a transition from this older building to a new, more state-of-the-art, actually beautiful building, that and that over time, you will never have more than 102.
That's
but
correct.
Over time, you will reduce the number of beds to 44.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. At this point, Jim, I'd also like to submit into the record, if I could, just three of the documents, which I don't believe have been in the record, just for sake of housekeeping, and that's the stormwater management concept approval, the NRI equivalency letter, and the woodland conservation letter of exemption.
Okay.
So it is. I'd also like to explain at this point in time the...
Okay, hold on a second.
Sure.
Figure out how to get this stuff in here. Okay. So, we have the Woodland Conservation Letter of Exemption application form. In response, okay, and that is accepted into the record as applicant's exhibit number three, the Woodland Conservation. Okay, then we have the application for the NRI equivalency, and it was an application for exemption, and the response from Environmental Protection, so we'll have that marked and accepted into the record as applicant's exhibit number four. And then we have the stormwater management concept approval from the Department of Permits and Inspections and Enforcement, and that will be applicant's exhibit number five, accepted into the record as such. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Operated by the Sisters Service of Mary Immaculate.
proposed revised conditions into the record as applicants exhibit number 6. And we have a number of other people who have signed up to speak, and if you have extra copies.
I pass them out already.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Okay.
I hope I got everybody there, so.
Did everyone who wants one receive one? Thank you. Okay.
So if I could, I'd like to go through these one by one and explain the situation. So the first is condition 1C, which originally suggests that we provide a 22-foot wide drive aisle adjacent to the loading space at the nursing home or relocate the loading space. We believe that at the current location, this can be accommodated, but what we have suggested here is that a better way to have this described and constructed is to allow for a 10-foot wide bypass lane adjacent to the 12-foot wide loading space so that it operationally would work well. And then we would add signage to indicate the traffic pattern for that loading space is one way only, so that it would come around one side, you would park the van, truck, wherever it would be at that location, unload, and then proceed along in the same direction out.
So let me say, Mr. Bishop, and presumably you spoke with someone from transportation. Did you have an opinion on this?
I did speak with someone from our transportation department and from our permits department, and this condition would seem would satisfy the requirement.
Okay. And then the signage would be helpful. Okay.
And the signage would be very helpful.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. Okay.
Next is condition 1D that now says adjust the grading behind the nursing home to a maximum slope of 3:1 to enable plant growth of vegetation as shown in the landscape plan. Adjust the retaining wall height as necessary and provide the details and specifications for a decorative block.
So just change height to design and then where the trees are, add where trees are.
Correct. And this is just to give us greater flexibility in balancing the areas of vegetation and retaining walls, and we want to do this to best accommodate the concerns of the neighboring citizens. We think that gives us a little more flexibility, but obviously we want the staff to make that determination.
Okay. And then about Mr. Bishop.
Yes, ma'am. I'm very in agreement with
thank you.
With that.
Okay. And then 1K corrects the maximum.
Correct. That's because for the reasons I stated earlier.
Yeah. Okay.
Correct.
We're in agreement.
Yeah. And that would be, that's clarifies on a whole lot. Okay. Quick. All right. Next condition, the new condition 1-0.
1-0, we're suggesting as a new condition, simply stating at the service entrance and signage stating as follows, emergency vehicles only beyond the service area, so that it's clear that all traffic has to only go in the service area, come back out, and does not go beyond. But we do need that for emergency vehicles, obviously. And other than that, Madam Chair, members of the board, we are in agreement with the staff recommendation and all other conditions as noted. And we do also respectfully request your support of that. I also just want to make a note before I ask Sister Rocha to stay up here with regard to our engagement with the community. As we're moving through this process, early mid-March, Sister Rocha sent a letter to the neighboring property owners, the adjacent property owners, because it was our belief that those are the property owners most impacted by the new building. Invited them to a meeting at the home on the evening of March 27th, which would allow us an opportunity to present all the plans, answer their questions, all that. We were there. There were only four, if I recall correctly, four or five individuals that did is why the remaining concerns, and you'll see what those concerns are, and that's fine. But I just want to be clear that my client voluntarily initiated engagement with the community. We have two meetings on site, and they did our very best to address the issues as best we could.
Okay, tell me the sister, tell the sister's name who organized the meeting.
Sister Vacha.
you so much on behalf of everyone.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Thank you.
Madam Chair, I do have a lot of people here to speak in support of the application. If you think it's appropriate to do it now, I'm happy to do so, but I leave it to you too.
Okay, we have a number of people signed up, so I'm just going to go down into some more. If you have some people you'd want to put forth first, that's fine.
Well, the rest of you, I want to have you have Sister Lodge speak to you specifically, but beyond that, the others are here to support, so however you want to do that. I would simply request respectfully of an opportunity to speak afterwards to any concerns that have been raised.
You absolutely have that right. Okay. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to go down the list. Okay, so let's start with, I can't read all these names. Having a handwriting issue. So, Anna Kedron. Is it Kedron? Something to that effect? No? You support? So please let the record reflect that, did I pronounce that? I probably didn't pronounce it correctly, did I? Okay, so Ms. Anna Kedron is present, in support, does not wish to speak. Okay. And by the way, we have a number of people signed up, so whether you're a proponent or opponent, if you want to indicate when I call your name, you feel free to do that, and I will note that. If you wish to speak when I call your name, you can come to the podium and feel free to do that. If you wish to adopt the comments of any prior speaker, you have the opportunity to say that as well. So you have three choices. Okay, Senator Rodriguez. Do you wish to speak? Come on down. I was trying to see who's here from the city of Hyatt. Oh, Mr. I'm sorry. Okay. Can you hold just 1 second? Ms. Gervis, okay.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the Planning Board. For the record, Katie Gervis.
Hold on a second. What's happening here? Okay, and did I call you? What's your name? I didn't know if I called you or not yet. So you want to do that now, or you want to do it? You're going to do it when I call you? No, I did call after the city of Pines. So I did call Sandra Rodriguez. Are you helping her? Is that what you're doing? I didn't. Okay. Okay. So let's go with Ms. Gervis first. Okay.
Okay. Again, for the record, Katie Gervis, planner for the city of Hyattsville. We have sent the planning board two letters with two separate dates. The most recent was dated on May 8th, and then the initial letter was sent on March 22nd. I just wanted to take a minute to kind of explain the reasoning behind these two letters and kind of the process that has unfolded. As you can kind of tell by now, we're having a lot of citizen concerns about this project, and the order in which we received them was a bit atypical from what we normally see, which is the reason why we sent you two letters. So just some background for you all, we began our review process for this in December of 2017. We followed our standard development review procedure, which requires a presentation to the City Council, a referral to the Planning Committee, which is made up of residents in the community, as well as then two City Council meetings after the fact, and then after that point, we allow our City Council to make a decision. All of those meetings are open to the public. Anyone is welcome to attend, to listen, to speak, whatever they may. On the meeting of March 19th, 2017, our City Council voted to support the DSP application that we are talking about today. As of that date, the only resident feedback we had received was from those who are members of the Planning Committee. We haven't had any other residents contact us with any concerns or support of the project. On April 29th of 2017, the city received the petition that you all now have a copy of, which was signed by approximately 100 residents. The petition listed out several concerns of this group of citizens, most notably concern about the tree canopy, stormwater management, and the proximity to the neighboring homes. As a result of that petition, our City Council felt it was important to revise their statement to you all to reflect that there were some concerns from the community. That's what you have in the letter dated on May 8th. In that letter, the city and at our council meeting, the city determined to retain support of the project, but wanted to make sure that the board was aware that there were a group of citizens who were concerned, and we transmitted a copy of that petition to you all in our letter. As far as the changes made by the applicant to the staff recommendation. The city is totally supportive of those. We don't have any issue with that. The other thing that I think may be important to bring up, and some of the residents in attendance might bring up as well, the question about the civic associations and whether or not they were notified. My understanding is all of the registered civic associations were, but this community does not have a registered civic association, which may explain why the information did not get to them in that way.
Thank you for that, because it's only we implore people regularly, if you have a registered, if you have an organized association, make sure they're registered with us. So that way you'll be required to have notice. Okay. Thank you so much.
Sure.
Are there any questions? Okay. Hold on a second.
Just a request. Can you work with the civic association that may not be registered to get them registered for?
So my understanding is there is not a civic association over there, but that's something that I can certainly talk to the residents that are here about and make sure. To my knowledge, the only civic association in the city is the University Hills Area Civic Association, and they are registered.
Okay, great. And then in the future, as your planning board meets, can if HOAs or civic associations come in, can you also work with them to make sure they get signed up for?
Yep, absolutely.
Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, thank you. Okay, Ms. Rodriguez.
Good morning. My name is Sandra Rodriguez. I'm a resident of 36th Avenue, 5709 Hyattsville. I live right next to the southern entrance. That's not my picture.
So let me hold on a second. So is this your exhibit, or whose exhibit is this?
It's not mine. So I want to clarify, we're a group of residents, and some of us feel stronger about some issues than others.
Okay, but I need to know, in order to get this in the record, I have to know what to call this. So this is,
I don't need this.
Okay, so this is not your, okay. So let's turn this off then, okay.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, go ahead, Ms. Rodriguez. Okay.
So I live by the southern entrance of the Sacred Heart Home, and speaking on my own behalf, I don't oppose the new building. I don't oppose the residents' right to have adequate place of living at the end of their lives. I have talked to Sister Basha that I am willing to volunteer for any Hispanic residents that would like additional visitors. But I do feel that as planned, the proposed site plan does not address all the issues of the neighbors, and there's going to be irreparable damage that...
Let me ask you this. Have you testified here before?
No.
Okay, so it's okay. So
yes, and I'm very nervous.
No. So everybody has a first time, so it's okay. We don't buy them anything, so it's okay. So what I need to know, I need for you to speak on behalf of you.
That's what I'm doing.
So I need to know. So tell me what your concerns are.
So I live right out on the southern entrance, and I have around...
Hold on a second, because Mr. Bishop is going to orient us to where you live.
Right.
Okay. So is that where you live?
Yes. So there are a lot of trees on the fence, across the fence from my house.
Okay.
And I also live downstream from the pervious areas that are the parking lot and the street.
Okay.
And I have a strong concern with that I didn't have an opportunity to participate in the storm water management drainage plan. And there are issues that at the meeting that we had with the proposers, I never got clarified. And that's whether the proposed and approved storm drainage system addresses the issue of runoff from the west, northwest side of their lot. And that is because currently, and I sent my own letter to you, currently there is a runoff issue. My street floods, and when it's freezing, it's very dangerous. When it snows, it's very dangerous.
So this, so your street floods, and are you, you're downhill from the...
Rest,
the
yes.
Okay. Okay, and so, and this, you're saying the storm water, then, it's the storm
I got to my concern.
Can I ask you another question? So, did you go to the March 27th or the April 18th meeting?
I went to both.
You went to both. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. And then, so I will tell you technically and legally, you have an existing problem with flooding and runoff. Technically, they are not responsible for correcting your existing problem with this new addition. However, what I also hear you saying is that you're concerned about your existing problem, but you're concerned that this may create additional problems for you. It might exacerbate it. And so we're going to have Mr. Taub address that afterwards.
And whether the capacity of the new system takes adequate consideration of the existing problem.
Okay. Okay.
And that is because one of the retaining ponds, I'm not sure that's the term they're using, is right next to my house above hill. So if the system doesn't work, it's my house that it's going to be affected. And I part of my house is right underground, so I'm really scared. I would like my concerns to be addressed, a good explanation. I would like to make sure that the technical design of the system addresses those issues.
Okay, so let me, Ms. Rodriguez, you signed this letter that was...
And I support it.
Oh, you do support it?
I support it because part of the tree issues also affect me and part of the neighborhood. The noise issue that is prevented by the trees also affects me.
Okay.
The road is going to pass above hill, but next to my house. So I do share a lot of the concerns with the neighbors. I have my own views on this particular street.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Are there any other questions from Ms. Rodriguez? Okay.
Madam Chair.
You have the flooding that's coming down on I think it's 36th Avenue. Where is that coming from? Is that coming from the roadway that's there, or is it coming from the higher grade of land?
It's a combination of all of them. And if you look at the water, it's
of the hill. And that's part of their project that is not going to be changed. So the problem, unless it's addressed, it's going to still be there. They don't have to, but it may contribute to whatever the system receives.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Are there any other questions of Ms. Rodriguez at this time? Is someone here from DPI? Can you help us here can you help provide some answers or no? Okay. Can you come on down, please, and identify yourself for the record? Thank you.
Steve Snyder with DPI, district engineer.
Can you adjust the microphone a little bit to your height? Thank you.
Steve Snyder with DPI, district engineer for this region. And so we do have an approved concept. The concept takes into account not only water quality, but also quantity. And so this site is going to be required to have on-site attenuation of the 100-year storm. And that's going to help.
You got to put that in layperson's mm-hmm. language.
Okay, so the larger storm event will be detained on site and then slowly released. So some of the issues that they're having now, that's not currently being done. So some of the issues they're having with large storm events will be mitigated with that. We're also going to make sure that the system, the storm drain system that goes down 36th
where the cursor is?
Yeah, by your house, 36th Avenue, there's going to be a storm drain system that goes down that road. And that system will be sized so that it can accommodate the entire property.
So that will help address the situation that Ms. Rodriguez is talking about? Okay.
That will help.
Okay.
Okay, so, I mean, you can see the way the grades are. I mean, they're at the bottom of the hill. So we're also going to recommend that inlets be put in along the swale that runs on the north side of 36. And I think there's a smaller swale on the south side, right where it leaves the property. So we're gonna ask the engineer to include that. But even more than that, there may be a need to collect stormwater that's shedding off that that slope, because it's headed right for her house. I mean, she does have that issue with the road, and she's told us about flooding and dangerous conditions in the winter with the ice and snow and everything. So if we collect that runoff from the road, that's good, but I think that slope's an issue, and that so should be.
So you're saying you can't do everything about the slope, but you what you're proposing will be of some help. Is that what I?
Yes. I mean, okay. We're.
And you talk with her directly?
No, I haven't spoken with her.
Oh, okay. So she spoke to someone, you're saying? Because you said you mentioned earlier that she contacted.
Oh, when I say we, I mean, it was discussed internally in DPI. We haven't spoken with Ms. Rodriguez.
Okay.
But, yeah, she does have an issue. I mean, it's not that uncommon. And I think we need to collect not only on the roadway, but also provide some sort of storm drain inlet to collect that water coming off the slope. Maybe a swale or something, because she does have an issue.
So when you say you think we should do this, are you saying it's going to be done?
Yeah, we're going to ask, as the permitting agency, we'll ask the engineer and the applicant to provide this.
Okay. Would you be willing to stay behind a little bit and talk to Ms. Rodriguez and if some others?
Sure.
Okay.
Can you just clarify for people who may not be familiar with your line of work?
Yes.
What's a swale? And then when you say mitigate, like, what do you mean by mitigate? What in common terms, what would that be for the?
Okay.
And also, can you tell me, I'm sorry, your last name again?
A Snyder, S-N-Y-D-E-R.
Okay, thank you. Okay.
Oh, so to mitigate would be when you have those big storm events, the objective in areas that do have downstream flooding, which apparently this one does, we ask the engineer to provide a means to collect the larger storm events and then slowly release so that they don't get a deluge. At the same time, and that's from within their collection system. I mean, maybe it's possible to provide that mitigation facility at the downslope and collect this water just before it sheds off the slope and hits her property. But if we can't do that, I think a swale, which would be like a ditch, to collect that water, put in a storm inlet, and then route that water over to the storm drain. So I can see like at least two inlets serving the road and maybe another one for the collecting water coming off the slope. But that's something we'll have to work with the engineer on. I don't think there should be a big objection to it, but I don't know.
Okay, Mr. Snyder, okay. Madam Vice Chair has a question.
When did this item come to your attention, the situation around her house?
Within the last couple of weeks.
In the last couple of weeks?
Yeah, okay. With the letter.
Okay.
Yeah, we weren't aware of the problem, but it's pretty apparent if you look at the contours that she has a problem.
Okay.
Okay, are there other questions of Mr. Snyder? Okay, so we may call upon you again, but in the meantime, you said you'd be willing to stay behind.
Sure.
A little bit. Okay,
yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, all right. Mary Graham? Okay. Please adjust the microphone too, and identify yourself for the record. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Chairperson Hewlett and members of the planning board. My name's Mary Graham. I live on 38th Avenue in Hyattsville, Maryland. We neighbors very much support the mission of Sacred Heart Home, caring for the sick and elderly. We're not opposed to a newer, updated facility. This is not about their ministry or the voices of their residents, some of whom know nothing about the intention of clear-cutting the eastern and southeastern sides of the property. This is about what those trees give us. In removing this mature stand of trees, we will lose the following things. We will lose our privacy. We will lose a natural buffer of sound and light pollution. Sacred Heart is a 24/7 care facility that serves people with delicate health, so there'll be vehicles and things at all hours. We will lose stormwater retention and aquifer recharge. The broadleaf trees that are currently there are naturally absorbent, and they capture rain and snowfall and then slowly release it into the ground and the air. The stormwater pond at the end of 38th Avenue that was put in when Independence Court was built does not do what its developers said it would do, although it does collect rubbish and breed mosquitoes. Currently, 38th Avenue and 36th Avenue sluice storm runoff into catchments that drain directly into the bay. We will lose passive seasonal air conditioning. Trees shade and cool roofs in high summer, but permit sunlight to reach them in the winter. We will lose native plants and other native pollinators. Insects, birds, bats that eat mosquitoes and other pests. In fact, the southern red oak, which I believe is in that stand of trees, although I haven't gone through those woods, hosts over 500 native species of pollinators throughout its range. We will lose the connection to nature. What's nicer than snow falling on every twig and branch of a mighty oak? And we will lose carbon dioxide sequestration, which occurs steadily in all large trees. Their removal will release this greenhouse gas back into the atmosphere. Mr. Taub's clients claim they will replace all these things, but let's be accurate. They will attempt to replace these things with solutions that are more convenient and less costly to them, but which are less efficient than already mature trees. Their replanting proposal replaces mature trees with saplings, which need decades to mature. The plan also includes Leland cypress, which are fast-growing trees. Their popularity has led to their overuse, and now they're victims of disease and infestation, which could require treatments with pesticides. No shovel blade has hit the ground, no chipper has been gassed up. Now is the time to preserve these trees. The proposed structure can be moved from the east and southeastern neighbors, thus allowing this mature stand of trees to continue doing what trees do best, providing a much-loved home for our entire neighborhood. One last thing. I want to thank the Sisters of Sacred Heart for their stewardship of these beautiful trees so far, and hope that stewardship continues for years to come. Kodai Anamjeva.
Did I say it right?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Do you have pictures to put in the record?
Nilsson, I can't read this so well. Nilsson.
Middick.
I knew that. Do you wish to speak? Yes. Okay, please come on down.
Hello, my name is Nelson Minnick. I'm a 37-year neighbor of the Sacred Heart Home. Over the years, I have regularly visited former colleagues there. I can testify to the excellent care which the sisters give to the patients there. And I am definitely in favor of the new facility. That is not the problem. The problem is the location of the facility. If I understand the plan correctly, the facility will have a service road that will run next to the backyards of the neighbors, and it will require the destruction of a large number of mature trees. My objections to their plan are three. One, the destruction of the trees. Two, the noise, the steady stream of noise which will result. And three, the storm runoff.
Okay, hold on a second. The noise, are you talking about the noise during construction or what?
Oh, that's one thing.
Okay.
No, I'm talking about what we can expect as a regular feature of the place.
Okay.
Let me concentrate my remarks initially on the noise. The design has a service road next to neighbor's backyard with a delivery trucks for the kitchen, medical supplies, ambulances, and of course, the notorious dumpster trucks. I can testify from my experience that the neighboring facility called Independence Court has dumpster trucks that show up early in the morning. I'm talking like 4 or 5 in the morning and make incredible noise. Bang, bang, as they empty their facilities. I hope that the Sacred Heart Sisters will prevent any dumpster truck from arriving at such hours in the morning, but this has not prevented that from happening over at Independence Court, and I strongly oppose such noise in the morning. Another noise feature, if I understand the design correctly, I can't quite show it. Over in the corner there is a small little protrusion from the facility, which I would like it. I suspect that that's a utilities building. Is that a power plant of sorts?
Hold on. You're not on the microphone. You need to be on the record. If you could keep track of these questions, I'm trying to keep track up here too. I'm running out of space here. Okay.
What I'm concerned about is noises coming from power plants. They're going to have air conditioning for the whole unit. There's going to be some kind of facility. I mean, I've seen these air conditioning things. There's a steady drone of noise coming from these things. You have to consider the features of the neighborhood. The home stands on a hill. Opposite is another hill, 39th Avenue. The neighbors exist in a bowl with these hills on the sides. And when noise is comes from the top of hills, barking dogs, you name it, it reverberates throughout the neighborhood. It's a bowl, and all the noise just bounces around in there. So these delivery trucks, ambulances, utility humming of air conditioning, all that, it's going to be destroyed. It's going to be very a nuisance in the neighborhood. Currently, it's a fairly quiet neighborhood, but I'm really afraid of what their design is going to do to creating noise in the neighborhood. A lot of these problems could be solved if they just move their plan further back. They've got extra property there. Why don't they just move it away from the neighbor's backyard? Just move the plan over toward Independence Court or toward Queens Chapel Road. You could flip the plan and solve a lot of the problems. You could put the Sisters Convent next to the neighbor's house and put the other one up there. That would solve all kinds of problems. It wouldn't be a new design. It's just a matter of flipping the plan and preserving the trees and keeping the noise away from the neighbors and moving it toward Queens Chapel Road. The service roads would go to the other side toward the Queens Chapel Road. So I don't see why we couldn't take into concern the neighbors, their concerns, and adjust the plan. It's not asking them to do a new plan. It's just moving it and preserving the trees and the natural barrier there. Another problem is the runoff. As mentioned by a previous speaker, as I said, there's a bowl here with the hills. And Independence Court, which is their neighbor, did create a pond. You can actually see it right there. That's it. It's totally inadequate. When we have big storms, that pond fills, and the streets, 38th and 37th, just floods of water come down, gravel, mud, vegetation debris. It's really a problem. And so if you're going to go on to that slope over there and destroy all the mature trees, strip bare it is what you're going to do, and put some little saplings in, this is going to exacerbate the whole problem. We're going to have even more mud and debris and gravel coming down that street. So I'm really concerned about the flood control element also. So in conclusion, I do support the sisters' work. I admire them. They do great work. I can testify to it. All the people I visit up there just praise the sisters, your wonderful work. It's just a and your design is beautiful. It's just a question of moving it away from the neighbors. Please respect the neighbors' concerns. It's just a matter of moving your design, keeping the buffer of trees. It's not a big deal. So that's my concerns. I thank you for your time.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Okay, thank you. Again, we have lots of speakers signed up. If you wish to echo any of the sentiments of a previous speaker, feel free to do so. If you wish to come to the podium when I call your name, please feel free to do so. I ask that we not be unduly repetitive. I mean, I know people want to touch on stormwater management and things of that nature and the trees. If you want to stay that, but not, if you're pretty much agreeing with some of the previous speakers, you can mention it and we'll keep on going. Thank you very much. Okay. And then also I want us to remember that Mr. Snyder from DPI is present and did talk about that stormwater runoff, and which will be helpful, I think. But he's also still here hearing everyone's concerns as well. So you know some of the things that DPI needs to take into consideration when the applicant comes in for permitting. Okay. Carmen Maldonado.
Good morning. My name is Carmen Maldonado, and I live on 5838th Avenue. First and foremost, I would also like to state my full support for the work and the ministry that Sacred Heart Homes provides to its residents. I am here today to share how the neighborhood will be impacted by the new development of Sacred Heart Home. On January 16, 2018, the planning committee members met with Sacred Heart Home. During that meeting, two council members expressed concern regarding the loss of trees and the impact the construction would have on the neighbors. However, this was taken lightly by the city council. One of the planning committee members even suggested if the building could be moved a bit towards Queen Chapel Road, as it seems to be better for the loss of trees, mitigating stormwater and neighborhood effects. Another member added that this would create a loss of trees in the area and also asked what sort of outreach has been done in the area. The response that they got was that there aren't many neighbors. Only three adjacent neighbors to the property of Sacred Heart received letters. However, it is not only the adjacent neighbors, the ones who will be affected by this proposed renovation, but everyone who lives on 38th, 37th, and 36th Avenue. We would like to preserve the residential character of our neighborhood and the wooded area. On March 9th, 2018, the planning committee members stated concerns again regarding the same issues that I just mentioned. However, city council members submitted a letter recommending approval without condition on March 22nd, and Sacred Heart Homes did not meet with the neighbors until March 27. The planning committee had recommended they reach out to us since January 6, 2018. Yet, adjacent neighbors were not contacted until March. Neighbors were not made a part of this process, and our opinions were not taken into consideration. City Council representatives did not do their due diligence and failed to represent their constituents. The Planning Committee said that this renovation will have minimal effects on the surrounding neighborhood. However, we submitted a petition with more than 100 signatures of neighbors opposing the proposed plan. That indicates the enormous impact this will have on all of us. Thank you.
Tell me, you're not part of a registered organization, so that's one problem, because the law says you send it to the neighbors, to the adjacent neighbors, but I know you're saying it's affecting more than that, and so as Commissioner Dorner indicated, it behooves, if you have a homeowner's, you don't have a homeowner's association either? Okay, so, okay, well, the law requires us to send out notices, that notices be sent to homeowners, registered homeowners associations, civic associations, community associations that are registered with us, and then to neighbors. And of course, then there was a sign posting, you know, in April. And I know the they said sister, how do you pronounce it again? Okay, sent notices. Yeah, I'm struggling up here. Okay, notices. Well, not notices, but invited folks to come to the meetings, and right. We did hear that some people attended either
yes.
one or both meetings.
Yes.
So I think there's been community outreach. You're in a quandary because you're not the whole neighborhood is not registered, but I think they're going to work with you per Commissioner Dorner's suggestion, and hopefully you can find a way to get registered so that you do have notices in addition to the sign posting that was sent out.
Did you go to the planning committee meetings?
No.
Okay, so I think that'd be the first place to start. They're always open to the public.
Yeah.
7 o'clock, usually once a month, in off of Gallatin Street in the city building. I think that'd be a first place for everyone who's interested in these kinds of things to get involved. Okay. And at that point, you could request either Katie or Jim, who run the meetings, to put you on a sign-up list so you get notifications from the applicant. Okay. And I think Katie can make that happen, hopefully.
Thank you.
So you come down to the microphone, though. Okay. Okay, Ms. Gravis, please re-identify yourself.
City of Hyattsville.
Okay.
One thing that we kind of internally as staff are doing as a response to this, because as Mr. Dorner knows, we have our planning committee meetings. We always welcome folks to come, but folks don't always either know about our planning committees, don't know that the projects we're talking about at the planning committees may be nearby them or affect them. And as is the case with this, the timeline for when that meeting was versus when residents got involved was a little bit out of order than what we would prefer to see. So one thing that we're working on doing right now is kind of changing our notification process to residents, making sure that they know about those things. But the other thing that we just started doing, and things are live on it right now, is we have a Speak Up website. It's a City of Hyattsville website where we post meeting agendas, projects that are happening, and it lets residents give feedback. Effective yesterday, all development applications will be posted on the Speak Up site too. So hopefully for the residents, that'll help them have a better idea of kind of what is going on, and then if they see that it's nearby or it's something that might be of a concern to them.
So they'll know substantively what's on the agenda.
Correct.
Right. Okay.
And then, so on the Speak Up website, do you have any way, like a forum that people can actually post questions if they have it and they mm-hmm. can't go to the meetings?
Yeah. So it's under the forum section on the website. So the way that we have it structured right now is we give, one paragraph kind of what is happening. We give a link to our website that has a more thorough detail of what's going on. We'll list all of the public meetings involved in it, and then we've also attached all of the presentations from the developments. And then at the bottom of the page, it says something like, post your thoughts here, or give us your comments, or something along those lines. And residents can go in, and then staff are notified anytime someone posts something on the site. So it's not helpful for this case because that has already passed, but hopefully it'll be helpful in the future to residents.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. Okay.
Thank you.
James Garay. Please adjust the microphone.
Good morning. Yes, I will. Oops. Sorry. My name is James Garay. I am a resident at 5800 38th Avenue. I am one of the...
Okay, can you... hold on a second.
Yes.
Mr. Bishop, can you orient us to where he lives? Mr. Garay lives?
Right, the little corner right there. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
If you can zoom in a little more, if you want.
Right there in the corner, you're saying?
Yes.
Okay,
right,
thank you.
Between right at the corner of 38th and 37th Avenues.
Okay.
I am one of the property owners most affected by this new project at Sacred Heart Home. Let me just state clearly that I do support the great work that Sacred Heart Home does in providing care for the elder. And in fact, I do support the new building. But the new building that as proposed right now is in the wrong location. You just have to move. It's in the wrong location for many reasons. And it just has to, I am asking to move it back for the preservation of the forested area that we got on the south edge of the property.
Okay.
The forested area has been there for decades and decades. And I think it's an addition, it's a benefit to the whole community on 38th Avenue and 37th Avenue. That makes us feel like We're in an urban setting, but we're surrounded by all these trees. Okay. That will be all gone if this project goes through as it's planned right now. That's going to be totally cut, all of that. And that's a major concern, and it affects me directly on my property. I actually wrote a couple of things here that I'd like to mention. Yes. How it would affect me.
Okay.
Okay. The loss of privacy.
Okay, hold on a second.
Yes.
Tell me what's happening over there. Because Mr. Garay is talking, and what are you doing?
Actually, we have a slide, yes.
So that's what I need to do. So this is your, is this an exhibit
this
that you're
trying
exhibit.
To? Okay. This is my exhibit, yes.
No one has said that, so I need to get this on to the record if, in fact, we're going to accept it as an
that
exhibit.
That is correct.
And I see Mr. Taub on his feet, about to be on his feet. Okay, so do you need a microphone? Mr. Bishop or Ms. Kosak, can you give the other microphone to Mr. Taub?
Is he okay?
Because he's the attorney for the applicant, so he has the right to comment on any proposed exhibit that's being proposed to be entered into the record. So, is that on? It doesn't.
Mr. Bishop, the slideshow is moving. We haven't made a decision on it.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, Mr. Taub.
Thank you, Madam Chair. For the record, I would object to the inclusion of the pictures. We don't know the particular vantage point from which it was taken. We don't know the lens which was utilized during which it was taken.
We can ask that question.
But you know, for the record, I would object to the inclusion of the pictures as suggested here.
But you don't even know what they are yet.
Well,
okay.
That's true. Just in general, we don't know the basis.
So tell me how many pictures you have here, and what are they, and this is your exhibit. Who took the pictures?
I did.
When you took the pictures?
Yes.
Okay. So Mr. Taub, are there any questions you want to ask of Mr. Garay?
Yes, Mr. Garay, can you tell me the date and time in which you took the pictures?
That was yesterday.
I took those pictures yesterday afternoon,
About what time?
I got home around 5 in the afternoon.
Can you tell me the type of camera and the lens that was utilized for this?
I use my iPhone. Everybody does that.
Okay.
Okay. Can you tell me the vantage point from which you took the picture?
Sure. If you want to...
Were they from
one.
Different vantage points or all from the same...
No, different vantage points. And we can probably go through at least a couple.
Okay.
Let's focus on one.
Okay. Yeah.
Can you open that
one
up,
please?
There we go. Okay. I am right at the corner in the intersection
That's
of...
That's your house right there?
That is my house, yes.
Okay.
Mr. Gary, can you tell me which streets are which? Which we see? It looks like you're on the corner, two streets there.
So we're standing here on 38th Avenue.
That's 38th, okay.
And to the left would be... 37th, the end of 37th Avenue coming up.
Okay.
Yes.
So 37th and 38th Avenues are perpendicular?
They connect at that point.
Okay.
Correct.
That's interesting.
and you can see all those, and you can see that high canopy, that is all planned to be cut off, clear cut.
Okay.
In which direction?
That's their property, the Sacred Heart property, the tree.
Correct.
Okay.
So you're looking, do you know which directions, like in northern direction?
This would be, it would be very close to being looking north, directly north.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Next. Okay, so your house, okay.
That's the same. Just turning down, turning to the left, that's...
Do you know how many pictures you have about?
I think I have about maybe 10 pictures.
Okay.
Right?
Okay, keep going. So.
And this is in between my house and my neighbor's house.
Okay.
That's the view there.
Okay.
On 37th Avenue.
Okay. Next.
That's the same. Sorry, keep going. This is standing at the corner in front of my house.
Standing at the corner in front, okay, there's your house. Okay, got it, okay.
Yeah, just.
Okay.
Yeah, getting closer.
Okay.
Keep going.
What do you have in that garden? Okay.
I'm sorry?
Nothing.
Thank you.
Okay.
I like to keep it that way. And that is now that we're looking slightly south in this direction, and I am standing at my neighbor across the street on 38th Avenue. That's Joe. I'm standing on Joe's driveway.
What's Joe's last name?
Rutledge.
Rutledge. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Pretty much the same. Yes. And now I'm standing back with a longer view so we can see the whole tree canopy that we'll be losing. Okay.
That's it. Okay, thank you. Mr. Tao?
I'll withdraw my objection. That's
okay,
fine.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so we'll accept this into the record as... I'm just going to call it, all right, because I don't know whether you're an opponent or not. You just want it moved. So.
I just, no, of course, I'm not opponent
okay, so
at
we're
all
call
the construction.
It,
I think the construction should go on. Yes.
Okay, we're going to call this citizen exhibit number one, actually. Okay. Okay.
Should I are the videos yours as well, or is it just the pictures?
Actually, there's a couple of videos that shows the runoff of let's show the second video on the left-hand side, that one.
Are these your videos that you took?
This is Sandra. It's from Sandra's house.
That you took?
She took.
Oh, okay.
May I clarify?
Yeah.
Okay.
When I sent my letter, this is Sandra Rodriguez again. When I sent my letter, I attached at least one of those videos.
Okay.
You may already have it in the record.
Okay.
So I don't need them to be included right now.
Well, it is. Okay, so even though you spoke first, this probably should have been citizen exhibit number one, but we'll mark it citizen exhibit number two.
I didn't want to add to the confusion because we weren't synchronized, but thank you.
Okay. Okay, hold on. Everyone who's speaking has to speak into the microphone so we can preserve the record. Okay.
So
thank you, Ms. Rodriguez. Is there something you wanted to explain or nothing?
This one is... After the hard rain has passed, when it's still flowing hard, on a single day, and the prior one, it's right when it was raining. It was a storm.
So is this that really, really, really bad storm that we had recently?
That was the latest one, the only one that I have taken because it was recent, and I didn't think of.
Do you remember the date?
I can give you more information out of my phone because it was taken with my phone.
Okay.
Andrew, can you back up just 1 second? Just minimize it after it's done. All the timestamps are on these files. So Mr. Todd was asking earlier is also on these files as well.
Okay.
So, I mean, it shows the dirt and the branches. It can happen when it rains this hard, but when it's freezing and when there's snow, all of that, it's really dangerous.
Okay.
And there's also some water accumulation on the other side of the street, but not as much as on my side of the street.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll have that marked and accepted into the record as, I think I'll do your 2A and 2B for your two videos. Okay. Mr. Garay.
Yes. So to continue with what I was saying here.
Microphone.
Sorry. Yes. Okay. Here we go. I just want to go briefly how it's going to affect me directly. The loss of privacy in my own backyard. The placement of the building is only 55 feet away from my property line. The road is only 20 feet away from my property line, and the building will be standing some 53 feet above my grade level of my property. The noise will be coming from the day-to-day operations of the facility that runs 24/7, all year round, the industrial-sized cooling and heating system and large generators. Light pollution at nighttime, I will not be able to walk out in my backyard on a, you know, without lights. And sometimes you just need a little bit of darkness and a little bit to enjoy your peace, that peacefully your backyard. Stormwater runoff, that's already been shown a lot. The increased utility costs of the destruction of the trees on the backyard. All of these adverse effects combine to make these homes less attractive, which equates to a loss in property values as a result of this proposed construction. So today, I ask you as a taxpayer and a resident to reject this plan as is currently proposed and approve a plan that allows for the preservation of the forested area along the south edge of the Sacred Heart Home property. No ground has been broken yet. Let's make this right and save our neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any questions, Mr. Gray? Thank you. Mary Herman? Followed by David Bickle. Please adjust the microphone. Thank you.
My name is Mary Herman. I live in Bowie, Maryland, but I've been associated with Sacred Heart Home since 2002 when I was looking for nursing homes and my mother went in there. And the facility, it's amazing what the sisters have done with a facility that old, but my mother kept looking around for where her bathroom was. I mean, you know, you have these needs and now you're looking at, but she adapted, she had memory issues. They took care of the whole thing, but the world is changing. And I was, Tuesday night, I was at the Glendale Hospital meeting for 2 hours while we talked about how baby boomers are, well, number one, we think we're gonna live forever and that we're not gonna get sick and we will never have to go in a nursing home. And we make plans for life insurance, but we don't always make the plan for where we will go. But what they were talking about is baby boomers are different and they don't understand what is going to be in front of them. But what they're going to need is they're going to need some place where they can be communal with other people, which this plan does. So you would have everything that has been good about Sacred Heart in terms of the caring of the sisters and the staff, as well as the ability to have a communal environment within the home and an outdoor space where they will be safe, because my mother could not walk outside because she would have wandered, and this way she would have been able to go into that kind of a space. So I support this plan, and I understand that there are issues with the site, but this is not, there aren't very many options on that site. Thank you.
Are there any questions? Thank you. Okay, David Bickle. No. I'm sorry. Okay. Joseph Welke.
Excuse me. Joseph General Potter is here to answer any questions.
Okay. So, okay. We did Anna. Okay. Marzina. Come help me out. Do would you like to speak? And then when you come up here and identify yourself, then I'll get it right. Okay, so please say your name for the record. Marchikowska. Sister Barchikowska. I think I'm close. Is here and in support. Okay. Marta Lipinska? Okay, she's present and in support, does not wish to speak. Okay, Danita Zelenska?
I'm in support of the fact of assistance.
Okay, please let the record reflect that Ms. Lipinska is here. Let the record reflect that Ms. Is it Ms. or sister?
Sister.
Lipinska is present and does not wish to speak, but is in support. Okay. Zelinska?
Zelinska?
Oh, okay, same person. Okay, I already did that. Okay. Okay, Judy Porter? Do you wish to speak? Okay. Didn't want to speak?
Yes, I do.
Oh.
No, Ms. Sister Zelinska?
Did you want to speak?
If I may.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry. I didn't realize you wanted to speak. I'm sorry. And then you'll be next, okay?
Danuta Zelinska.
Sister, adjust the microphone. Thank you.
Sister Danuta Zelinska, I just want to let you know that I have been involved in the entire project from the beginning. I also work at Sacred Heart for the 14 years, and we have explored every avenue to save the building and to deal with the environment we have, but it's impossible as of now. The project we undertook is only to improve quality and care for all the residents we have there, and this is the best plan we could come up with the site. There is not much option for the area we have there. So for the all the concern of the neighbors, it wasn't taken lightly. We explored every avenue before we decided about the site of the plan. Thank you.
Are there any questions? Okay, thank you. All right, Judy Porter.
My name is Judy Porter, and I'm currently reside at Sacred Heart Home. I have been a resident there since August 2015. I am 65 years old, and I believe I'm the youngest resident there. Mm-hmm. Sacred Heart is my home and where I expect to reside the rest of my life. I am extremely interested in these proceedings as well as the final decision. I am the voice of my fellow residents. I represent those unable to verbalize their desires and for those physically unable to attend. The plans being approved for Sacred Heart Home are paramount to all of our futures. I have lived in two other nursing homes, and I will spare you the negative details of those. Sacred Heart is by leaps and bounds the best place I have lived. The staff is caring and loving. They work hard to meet our needs and at times our desires. The nuns are hard workers as well. We see them often on the floors and other parts of the building. I am not Catholic, but I have been welcomed and treated with respect and the best of care. I have gone from being bedridden to zooming around the facility. I have been threatened with speeding tickets in the halls. The physical therapy staff is taking me from not standing on my own to walking with a cane for short distances. The occupational therapy staff has increased my ability to dress and care for myself. Activities have gotten me out of my room. I have served 1 2-year term as the president of the resident council. Sacred Heart Home is here to make a difference in people's lives. They are a nonprofit facility. Sacred Heart is a refuge and a retreat for elderly people who need a place to spend their last years. The nuns and the staff do their best to care for us and to brighten our lives. The new facility will be a lovely and more efficient addition to the area and to us as residents. The existing facility was built in 1926. So it's definitely time for a new place. I don't know all the issues that will be presented by our neighbors today. I feel for certain one will be the fact that the land will be cleared and trees removed. I feel certain that the balance of nature will be respected by the new plans. Trees were disturbed and removed when the surrounding neighborhood was built. The current grounds are lovely. I'm sure the new landscaping will be lovely as well. The land is a peaceful respite from the surrounding hustle and bustle. Noise from construction may also be an issue. The current neighborhood also produces noise when individual repairs and construction projects happen. As an individual, I do not believe the neighborhood respects Sacred Heart's property or our safety. Many use the driveways, although it is posted as a private drive. They also do not use appropriate speeds. The staff, family, and friends drive the correct speed. I myself have had to dodge many unknown vehicles driving too fast or not in an appropriate lane on the driveway. This is a no-win situation for me, but much worse for the less agile residents. I have also observed the grounds being used for dumping litter from unfamiliar cars. I believe the new facility will be an asset to the neighborhood and the city. It will be a much needed update as the current building needs constant repair. I hope the citizens of Hyattsville will listen and accept the new Sacred Heart home. Thank you for your time and attention. I appreciate the work that you do for my county.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Porter. We appreciate your testimony. I just have to say one thing. When you said you represent the other residents there, unless you're an attorney, you cannot represent them.
Used the word as I am
speaking for them. You're one of the, okay.
I wasn't trying to be legal at all.
I know, but I just have to correct that for the record. You're speaking for yourself, and maybe, and perhaps some of the other people may feel as you do. Okay. But I appreciate your comments.
I'm a teacher, not a lawyer.
Okay, thank you. We appreciate your comments. Okay. Okay. Were there any questions? Okay. Okay, now. I don't know. I'm looking at the handwriting here. So is it Laughlin? Sofield?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I am Brother Lachlan Sofield, and I am the director of a retirement house for priests and brothers. I'm here to speak in favor of the proposal. My concern is for the quality care for our elderly and ill people. And I found no place, I deal with a number of different facilities, I found no place that provides better quality of care than Sacred Heart. But the facilities need to be replaced. There's no question about it. Last Saturday, we had a funeral for one of our priests. He was at Sacred Heart for about 7 years, and every time I would visit him, he would tell me the exact same thing. He would say, I'd rather be back home with you guys, but if you have to be anyplace else, this is where we should be. I've had a total of over 20 men who have gone there, and it has just been the most wonderful experience for them. But the facilities need to be replaced. Recently, one of our employees told me that she might have to quit after working for us for 26 years because her mother has dementia, and she could no longer take care of her mother and work. She went to Sacred Heart. Sacred Heart took her in, and she now her life has changed. I just say that there's the quality of care that they are offering is just extremely beyond anything I've ever seen. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any questions of Brother Sofield? Thank you. Okay. Christopher Curry, followed by Anthony Murphy.
Hi. My name is Christopher Curry. I'm a resident of Hyattsville. And I'm speaking.
Can you raise the microphone a little bit? Thank you. Okay.
I'm a resident of Hyattsville, and I'm speaking in favor of the development proposal. My experience with the sisters in the home is mostly through my children, who have been volunteers there over the years. In fact, my daughter, Katie, just got in from college late last night, but she wanted to be here to support the sisters. So. Sacred Heart Home has been a jewel in Hyattsville. I don't think anybody here disagrees with that. You know, it's remarkable that it's consistently rated one of the top three nursing homes in the state by the state of Maryland, in spite of the antiquated facility. I have a friend who is taking care of many elderly people and served as power of attorney for many. And, you know, he says the sisters are the best but the facility is just substandard. It's well cared for, but it wasn't built to be able to care well for the elderly as we can do today. It's really important that they be allowed to replace it with a state-of-the-art facility. And I think it's really wonderful that our county has an opportunity here to have not only the best people caring for our elderly, but to have a facility that also is on par with the best, and that the many poor and disadvantaged people that it serves will be cared for as well or better than the wealthy folks who live around the rest of the city. And I think that's a good thing that we're able to offer some of our residents, thanks to the work of the sisters. I will say that I feel very, very much sympathy for the neighbors. Obviously, you know, they have a very nice environment, other than the stormwater problems, which hopefully will be taken care of. But it's nice. It's like having a private park next to your home. It's a very different environment than the vast majority of Hyattsville, which is a more urban sort of setting. And I'm sure I would be disappointed to be losing those trees next to me as well, and having a larger building instead. But I think it is important to note that it's not a public park. The sisters have been there for almost 100 years. Before this order was running it, there was another order of sisters running it. So it's been almost a century before any of those homes were constructed that this ministry has been going on that property. And whenever you buy into a neighborhood and there's private property nearby and they have a right for that use, then you're taking a certain chance. And I hope that, you know, provision is being made, and I'm sure this board and the staff are being careful to make sure that the interests of the neighborhood are being well protected. But I would hate to see, you know, a wonderful project like this not happen because of those concerns. That's all I have to say.
Thank you. Mr. Cross, we have a particular affinity. Well, first of all, are there any questions to Mr. Cross? We have a particular affinity for our young folks in the county. So I heard you say that your daughter just arrived from college last night and wanted to be here. So if you could tell us her name and where she's in school, and thank you for exercising your civic interest at such a young age. Yeah. We appreciate that.
Her name is Catherine Curry. She's at school at Franciscan University of Steubenville, Ohio.
Okay.
And she's finishing her sophomore year.
Okay, wonderful. Okay, so welcome back. Okay,
yeah,
thank you.
Thank you. And I could say one more thing real quickly. I used to serve on the city council in Hyattsville, and I was known as the tree advocate. Okay. And so I completely understand the value of trees. I did a lot to try to protect trees and try to enhance the tree canopy. You know, right now I'm working on trying to protect the new trees that are going to be planted in the new median right near that property, which, unfortunately, not these people here, but people in the general neighborhood ask for fewer trees. So now hopefully we'll be able to restore the original intent of planting more trees. But to some extent, the public body, the city council, has to take responsibility for protecting and enhancing the tree canopy in our city, and that's not, it's not, shouldn't be all put on the sisters for that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, Anthony Murphy.
Good morning. My name is Anthony Murphy. I'm a resident of the 4000 block of Madison Street in Hyattsville. I'm here to support the proposal. I first got to know the sisters several years ago when I had an elderly aunt who was looking for a nursing home. She wound up aging in place, staying in her own home until she passed away. But I've stayed in touch with the sisters over the years, visiting the home and the residence, and we've gotten to know them. The facility is, as everyone knows, it's very old. one thing that hasn't been mentioned about the age of the facility is that the steps in front in that main entrance are very high, because when that facility was built, the first floor is really high. And so it may not affect the residents. The residents don't have to go in and out of those front steps every day, but anybody coming to visit those residents has to go up and down those very, very steep brick steps. It's 92 years old. There's no central air conditioning, which is extraordinarily energy inefficient. That's not environmentally friendly. Just given the topography of the property and the need to continue to run the old property while the new property is being built, it doesn't seem to this layman to have many options for siting the new property anywhere else. I wish there would, or to, which of course also affects the trees, but I don't see, given those two conditions, topography and the need to continue operating the old facility while building the new one, I don't see a lot of options there. But I'm just here to support and thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any questions of Mr. Murphy? Thank you. Joseph Gigliotti?
Gelati.
Yes. I knew that. Okay.
Well, okay. Easy
name. Okay. Gelati. Okay. I don't mean any harm, but it's making me think of my trip to Italy.
Happens all the time. My name's Joseph Gelati, and I'm a lawyer in Hyattsville. I live in Hyattsville, and my mother lives at Sacred Heart. She's almost 95 and a half, and she lived with my wife and I. She lived on her own for quite most of her life. My father died years ago, and the last 5 years she came to live with us, and during that time she broke two hips, and she's got a bad right leg, and she's not walking anymore, and her gerontologist finally said to us that she should go to a home. And I had been in touch with Sister Anna, who's here. She's a social worker at Sacred Heart, and I also had have an old friend who was the lifelong custodian, Frank Abbey, who's now retired. But I had always heard that Sacred Heart was a caring, loving place. I was worried because I also knew physically it was a very old place. But we visited a few times, and Sister Anna showed my wife and I around after the gerontologist said, it's time. I resisted. And my mother's life has completely changed since she's gone to Sacred Heart. We are Catholics, and they have daily liturgy. But they also have liturgy for non-Catholics, and my mother has attended a couple of Bible sessions with some Protestant ministers as well. And as Mr. Murphy has said and others, it is a very old facility. My mother has a nice room. You could eat off the floor. They clean it every day. But she doesn't have private bathroom facilities, for instance, that she has to go down the hall, and she's in a wheelchair. Socially, it's wonderful. Spiritually, it's wonderful. I think the only lacking thing is, and it's very clean, but it's physically lacking, and because it's old. And it is also a very beautiful private space in an urban area. There's no doubt about that. And I have no doubt that the sisters and their contractors will do everything they can to preserve the neighborhood, because they have for 100 years. It's a lovely place. My mom's life has totally changed. Her mind is good. Her body's going. And they just take great care of her. It's a wonderful, wonderful place. And I when my wife and I were looking for a room, Sister Anna was showing us around. My mom, when she broke her hips, had been in other rehabs, other nursing homes, and they always smelled. And my wife said, "Do you smell anything?" When we were in Sacred Heart, and I didn't smell a thing. So I of course endorse the sisters' plan, and I just knowing them, they're going to take care of that neighborhood, and I want to assure the neighbors of that too, as a Hyattsville resident. So I thank you for your consideration, and I certainly endorse this project.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gelati. Appreciate
yes.
it. Okay, got it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so that concludes the sign-up sheet that I have. Was there anyone who wished to speak whose name I did not call? All right, Mr. Taub, you get summation at this point. And then you're it between us and lunch.
Okay. Understood. I just want to just address a few points that were raised by some of the concerns that were raised here, and I think we'll try to be very brief about that.
Okay.
But I would ask Sister Vacha to come up just to discuss the nature of...
Yeah, because I think it was getting kind of muffled. If you could just orient the microphone a little better. Okay, thank
How's
you.
How's that?
Okay.
I would just like to ask Sister Vacha to come up just to discuss the nature of the deliveries that will be coming in. And again, we'll be very brief about this. But
okay, and while you're doing that, let me just tell you some of the things that I jotted down, and maybe others have some, but, and I'm sure you were taking copious notes too, but obviously there's the issue about the runoff. We have Mr. Snyder here as well. The issue about the trees, although I have some comments about that too, the issue about the noise and the route that they will take, which
right.
Sister will address, and constant traveling, and what Mr. Garay said about the road being 24 feet away from his house, and then a couple of people raised the issue about the buffer and losing some semblance of privacy. I mean, I know it's not their property. It's
We understand.
Sacred Heart's property. A couple of people talked about, you know, reorienting the property so it's faces it's closer to Queens Chapel Road, and a couple of people just mentioned flipping the convent and the nursing home. So those are some of the things that I wrote
down.
Okay.
Pretty much where we're going to go here. Let me state, first of all, before I call up Sister Vacha, actually, talk about the stormwater management. Please bear in mind, this building was built in 1926. There was no such thing as stormwater management regulations. None. Zero. There is nothing on the property in the way of stormwater management currently. We completely sympathize with the citizens as to what is happening there, but that's just the way it's a relatively steep property. That's the nature of the property. It was simply nature taking its course. As you've seen here, and as Mr. Snyder pointed out, there will be stormwater management as a result of the new construction, and it will be to the current regulations. And I will not stand here and tell you it will be a 100% solution to all of that, but it will be to current county and state regulations. And that's important to understand. So there will, I believe it's fair to say that there will be significant improvement as a result of the imposition of stormwater management where there is none currently. I won't go over the details again because Mr. Snyder did that very well. But obviously we do have to work with, and we will be working with DPI as that moves along. So that's with regard to that issue. I would ask Sister Vacha now to come up just to talk about the frequency of deliveries and where they will be coming. So just come up for a moment. Just briefly talk about that.
Sister Vacha Klujak, I just wanted to talk briefly about the deliveries. Since the home is going to be downsized, we're going to have only 44 residents, it's more towards residential. So the deliveries will be less frequent. The frequency will be much lesser. We have another facility in Catonsville in the suburbs of Baltimore, which is 44 beds, and I have been working there as well. I know the reality and I have the experience, so let me tell you, the frequencies will be much lesser, and I don't think that it will have a considerable impact on the neighborhood and on the residents, our residents as well.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'd like now to call David Bickle, who is our landscape architect from Soltes, to talk about both the location of the building on the property and the issue of the trees.
Hello, everyone. My name is David Bickle with Soltes. Just like to mention a few things concerning, actually, I was the landscape architect on site talking to Ms. Rodriguez that didn't answer so well in engineering terms. Actually, I was there so we wouldn't have that problem of speaking engineer to one another. And apparently, I didn't do as well at that point either. So I apologize for my translation of engineer into common language. But concerning, I think most of the runoff questions, with regard to this site being built 1926, it's obvious that that would happen. You would see the runoff on the streets. Honestly, I looked again on our survey. I don't think there's an actual storm drain on the site. I don't think there's even a single storm drain currently on the site. So what you have is conditions from 1926. And then, of course, you have the single family houses coming in starting 1940 to 1947. So they've been in that condition, you know, at least 70 years currently under that condition with no stormwater management. So again, the concerns of the residents understood. That's the existing conditions. And with all the proposals and the new regulations, we propose to make that better. Okay, so concerning the stormwater. Concerning the trees themselves, I believe they've been mischaracterized as a forest. We have a woodland conservation exemption. There are quite a few mature trees, larger trees. And when you actually go out to the site, it's more of a campus feel. If you're like on a college campus, it has the larger trees, no understory. So that's really what's making up the canopy, larger trees. So it's not a forest in the sense that it's a regulated forest, but it's a lot of mature trees. A lot of those mature trees are aging also. I'm not saying they're all gonna die the next week, but eventually they do come down too. And when those trees been there since 1920s, those trees eventually have a lifespan too. So I actually, one story that they related to me was one of the trees that was hit by lightning, which just became a glowing fireball that was there. So it happens. The trees are there. They also don't last forever either. I just like to make that point. So some of the trees on the lower south property, where all the neighbors have concerns, again, there are mature trees there. When you have five or six of them, if you look through that, you can see how it is relatively sparse. But when you have larger trees, they do make up a canopy that show that. So when you clear two, the four, six, eight trees, it makes a big impact because they're mature trees. So I just wanted to at least clarify the feel of the site. It is more of a campus feel with the larger trees. It's not a forest, but it will have an impact. And the two times that I spoke to all the residents, I was upfront with them saying it's gonna be an impact. It's relatively shocking when you're living next to trees and somebody's developing something there. I didn't try to hide anything from anybody when we just explained that to them. And then some of the other steps that we took just to help with this, on the backside is where the grading, most of that is occurring. And our original, the other side. So our original design had a larger, higher wall. Our current design breaks it down into two walls. The lower wall is 2.5 feet high. Again, a step wall. I always, you know, show that it's like 2.5 feet. And then the second wall is 5.5 feet. And then with the current conditions from staff, we're looking to revise that, potentially making it three smaller walls altogether, so that it actually terraces into the hillside. We didn't want to propose some giant wall that's backing up against the residents. So we took some consideration into that, and we still have some flexibility to make it even a little better than what it was. With regards to the building itself, the front of the building is the first floor. And then when you walk into the front first floor, it's only one floor until you get to the backside. It's more like a walkout situation. So you see most of the building is actually buried into the hillside. Okay, so you can see the upper floor there will be buried into the hillside. So the design of the building was actually meant to be put into the hillside. And there is a lot of slope, a lot of different grade on this site that makes it.
So you're saying it's not going to be so super.
It depends on which side you're on.
Okay.
On the front, it is going to be lower. On the back, it is going to be 35 feet.
Okay.
The building, but 35 feet. Today's standards with houses, residential houses, are around 35 feet. The current existing neighbor's homes built in the 40s are two and a half, or actually two stories with a basement, some around 25 to 30 feet tall, just to kind of give you an idea of the surrounding houses. So the nursing home itself is, you know, 35 feet on the backside. It's very comparable to a single family house, of course, maybe 7 to 10 feet tall.
35 feet on the backside, and what again on the front?
It's like, I believe it's 15. I don't know exactly.
So I know Mr. Gray said he thought it was going to be 50 feet above his house.
Okay, so he's talking about change in grade.
Okay.
So from the backside, you can see that at the bottom, it, of course, if you're looking from the bottom grade in his backyard is around 94. And then if you go from that point and then look up to the top of the gable, yes, it's a change of grade,
okay,
elevation. But the site in itself, from the highest point currently over the overall site, it changes over 50 feet already, the site. From the highest point on the site near the current nursing home to the west, from the top, the adjacent assisted living on the north. From there down to his property, there's already a grade change of 50 feet, okay? So like I said, we're building the building into the slope. Now the other consideration, the road in the back, it's not an access road, it's a fire lane. It's requirement for fire safety. So if we can get rid of that, we'd be more than happy to move that, to get that out, but it is a fire lane. And then we also propose a new condition concerning no deliveries beyond this point, basically emergency vehicles only. So that will operate as a fire lane. It is there for that purpose. Like I said, if it can get reduced, we will reduce it. But currently, that's for fire safety for the building itself. And then the location of the building with regard to moving it forward, the limitation comes in the existing power plant that runs the existing building. Everything, yes, it's right there where he's pointing. Where that building is cannot allow the new building to go further, because if that building is taken offline, the current nursing home doesn't exist. It can't operate. So we're limited in space regarding the moving of the new building forward. So I think, let me see, buffer. I don't know, is there any other questions?
Mr. Minnick mentioned that it's over to the right. Mr. Bishop, I think he thought it might be a utility space.
Yes.
Or could you just talk about what that is?
A generator.
Now,
let me explain that also. So currently, they also have you have to look at it from a viewpoint that there's an existing building that also has a generator, that also has trash delivery, that also has different utilities. We're reducing the scale from 102 bed to a 44 bed. Of course, the location is now different. It's adjacent to it, but it's going to be similar or not less than what was already existing on site. So this nursing home is not new to the site. It currently exists and operates as a nursing home, except for the position of it did move towards that direction.
So on the wall that you have, the two-tiered wall,
yes.
Are you going to have any sort of stormwater drainage from there? Because if you're taking out some trees and you do lose some absorption of any sort of runoff, is there going to be any kind of system that will take the runoff from there and move it to like the lower quadrant back towards the streets where DPI can actually maybe control it a little bit better?
Yeah, actually that is the plan, is to separate and diverse. When you do stormwater management, I'll try not to be too, you have a 20,000 square foot drainage area that you have to divert all your water to. So there's different areas where you divert these to. So as you see on the plan, there's different areas where water will be diverted to and eventually go to one point, like Mr. Snyder said.
So if you're looking at where the wall is, right where the cursor is, will the water be running then to the southwest into those ponds?
It'll run to the south. Yes, that's correct.
Okay. And then the new surfaces that you have, because the roads actually aren't existing in there, is there any way that you can use materials that are more friendly to absorbing water? I know we have a couple of sort of new things in the county, mm-hmm, where we have supermarkets and other places that have used sort of recyclable or different materials that can better absorb the water kind of coming through.
Yes.
Is it possible you can do that instead of sort of typical asphalt?
I can have our engineer team definitely look at that.
Okay.
Because I think any helpful amount of absorbing that water will be beneficial.
Yeah. And what? So you may not be able to answer this, but what's going to happen to the old facility after you get the new one built, assuming that you get approvals? What happens to the old one and what's there right now?
Commissioner, that will be demolished eventually. Hear that? Once all the transitioning occurs, we have all the residents in the new facility, that will be demolished, and you'll see on the plan we showed that as a future green area. So that will be reestablished as a green area where it is currently.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Are there any other questions?
Mr. Taub may have more.
Mr. Taub.
No. I'm just happy to answer any other questions if there are any. That's all.
Why can't the
general... Wait a second.
Okay.
Thank you.
I was talking to Mr. Taub.
Excuse me?
I was just talking to him at the question. Okay, but in terms of summation, are you done?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think it's fair to say that we have, you know, we have done everything we can. I think that David's testimony indicated that the location of the building is where it has to be. It cannot be located elsewhere. We have done everything we can with regard to retention of existing trees on the west. We have, as you can see, significant new plantings coming in, new trees coming in, that actually will, even though we're not required to meet the landscape manual, will meet the landscape manual requirements. So we've done what we can do with regard to that issue. And I think in general terms, we have done everything we can to respect the property. We have met every regulation, county and state regulations for this proposal. We believe that it is supportable. We would request your support respectfully.
May I just ask one more follow-up question? Okay, so... I know Ms. Graham mentioned this, and I know there's a lot of talk about the trees, and I know we're interested in preserving trees when we can. I also understand what Mr. Curry said, that even though he's a tree preservationist as well, this is still property that the Sacred Heart owns.
It
and
is.
So people do have an expectation when they live somewhere and they move somewhere, that those trees that may not belong to their property will stay there, but that's not always the case. Mm-hmm. It's not always the case. And what we have to do up here is balance competing interests. So we have the interests of the residents who live there versus the interests of the Sacred Heart. And we do this week in and week out, balance competing interests. And one of the things that was raised was a buffer, that they lose privacy. It's privacy that they've gotten used to, not necessarily that they're entitled to, but they've gotten used to because it's been there for all these years and the trees have been there all these years. And I don't know if you gave any consideration to any other type of, I know you're going to be planting some trees, but is there any other type of buffer that you have considered?
Well, I know this, that after we had our first meeting with the citizens, and Mr. Garay and his fiance came to that meeting and expressed their concerns, at that point, and you can note there, we actually, we added some supplemental plantings against his property in there.
Okay.
So we did try to address, to the extent we could, some of his particular concerns. So that was added specifically as a result of the issues that we heard from at least Mr. Garay and his fiance with regard to that. Ms. Rodriguez was mostly concerned about the stormwater management. We explained that situation. We do hope and we expect there will be significant improvement. We obviously, it will be to all current county and state regulations. But with regard to buffering, we have provided, as you can see, actually a very significant number of new plantings in there, many of which will be, you know, certainly there will be some significant trees, some medium. I mean, David, is that fair to say? These are not just small trees going in.
and maybe Dave can speak to it just briefly, but I mean, it's basically it's a combination of large trees, medium trees, and shrubbery in there. And as David indicated, we're trying to also deal with the issue of retaining walls, so it's not a towering, you know, looks like a castle that you're looking up to there. We are trying to do this in a way that can best accommodate the views of the neighbors and to not let this look like it is something like the castle on the hill. You know, it's not the easiest thing when you're basically creating a new environment here, but we're doing the best we can to, we certainly, like I said, to meet all the requirements, but also to respect the views of the neighbors in the process and what we're doing what we can.
Okay. One other thing. Let me ask Mr. Snyder, is there anything else that you wanted to add, having heard the testimony of the residents there? I mean, you don't have to, but if you do have anything you want to add.
I don't, in general, no, I can speak specifically.
So, okay. So in general, no, but you are going to speak to them afterwards. Okay, Mr. Taub, I don't know how this vote's going to go, but depending on how it goes, I would hope that and you, and we have the city of Hyattsville here. Ms. Gerbis is here, so she's going to endeavor to reach out to the citizens. I hope that you all will continue to be good neighbors. Clearly, the citizens support the Sacred Heart Home, but so that was unanimous. But their concern is for their own homes, and that's understandable as well. So I'm hoping that you will continue to have conversations no matter what.
We're always open to that, Madam Chair.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Are you trying to ask a question?
I just wanted to, may I say something? I just wanted to say I'm not sure that you know this, but there is a tree ordinance in Hyattsville, and you need to get a permit from the city anytime you take a tree down that has a circumference greater than 48 inches and 48 feet up.
So they need to know this, you're saying. Okay.
Yeah, so we are all subject to those rules.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so Mr. Taub, you get the final word on behalf of your applicant in accordance with our planning board rules of procedure.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'll be very brief. First of all, yes, we're very much aware of that, the tree ordinance in Hyattsville. I think I've said all that we can. We've done the best we can to situate the building where it is. There's really no other location on this property where it can be located. We've tried to respect the citizens best we can with buffering, and we would, for all those reasons, respectfully request your support. Thank you very much.
Does the board have any questions of anyone? At this point, I'm sorry, they got summation. They were last now. Okay, does the board have any questions of anyone? Is there a motion?
Yes, Madam Chair, and I want to thank especially the citizens for coming out, and obviously those associated and affiliated with Sacred Heart as well. But I move that we adopt the findings of staff and approve DSP-17053. Along with the associated conditions as outlined in staff's report and as further modified by applicant exhibit number 6, in addition to accepting proffered condition, applicant proffered condition number 10.
We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there discussion? Under discussion, I would just say I too thank everyone for coming out, and I thank the folks in support of Sacred Heart and the citizens who live nearby for coming out, and actually Mr. Snyder from DPI for coming out too, and for remaining behind. As I said earlier, we are in the business of balancing competing interests, but all of our decisions have to be made in conformance with all the laws that we have to abide by, the state laws, all the county laws, and all the Supreme Court cases. And I think Mr. Taub hit the nail on the head in that they have met every legal requirement that they will meet. I think some good comes out of this in that when Sacred Heart was built, there was no stormwater management requirement whatsoever. So I think you will have some now that will improve the situation. It may not make it perfect, but you do have Mr. Snyder here who will take these concerns back to DPI. And you all have, as citizens, have the right to continue to talk with them so they fully understand the magnitude of the problem. I also think some other good came out of it, even though you're not a registered association, the city of Hyattsville is taking some steps to make sure that you're heard and you're involved early on in the process so that you have sufficient notice. I think they heard you in the sense of creating some, putting some additional planting and buffering in for the sake of privacy. And then again, as I said, we balance competing interests. And what happens is people get used to their neighborhoods the way they are. We all live in Prince George's County. We are all used to our own neighborhoods the way they are. And then when development comes in, I have to tell you, when it's come to my neighborhood, I get like that too. It's like, okay, wait a minute. This is going to be increased traffic, increased noise, and increased this. But when things meet all the criteria, when developments meet all the requisite criteria, then we are prohibited from denying the application because the courts deem that arbitrary and capricious. That's the term that they use for that. So I think some good has come out of this. And when I hear people say that they're used to trees, you know, I think about the people who were there before you were there, and those folks were used to a neighborhood too before trees were cut down for your homes. So it's always, there's always that continuum. And it's difficult for us to balance those interests, but we do that in the best we can, hearing the concerns of the citizens, trying to address what we can address, not that we have the ability to address everything. So I just wanted to thank everyone for coming out. I'm hoping that you will continue to work together. You know, it's a beautiful community, and Hyattsville is absolutely beautiful, and so much, doing so many great things in Hyattsville. So I'm hoping that that you will continue to work together as Hyattsville is uplifted today and from here on in. Is there any, Commissioner Dorner?
So I'll echo those comments and also say that I live in Hyattsville. So I know a lot of these areas, and there's a lot of work going on in Queens Chapel right now. There's a lot of nice things that are happening around the city. And I would encourage all of you to get involved. The Speak Up program that Ms. Gerbes has mentioned is very good. It involves a lot of the citizens. I participated in before. I used to be on the planning board. And we didn't get many people coming out there and voicing their opinions. And it helps to get involved earlier on. That way you can raise these kinds of concerns. There's a lot of ability to do that if you connect with the city. And then you can get in front of the developers. You can talk to them. You can talk to the applicants before it sort of comes before us. Because at this point, it's very difficult to make major changes, right? It's very long into the process, even though there haven't been any shovels that hit the ground, as you guys have said. It is kind of farther along in the process. But get involved early. There's a lot of stuff happening in the community. Go to the planning board meetings, because people go there, and they're super interested. And there's lots of different varieties of opinions. And it's great to have citizen involvement. So thank you for coming out today. And for all the background research with all the photos and the effort that everyone put in. It was very, very well done on both sides, so thank you. And obviously, the applicant has seen that these people aren't in opposition of your project. There's just certain concerns that hopefully you guys can control and help work with them. But I think overwhelmingly, there wasn't a single person in here that said that they didn't want to see this. And there's everyone, I think, said that they appreciate Sacred Heart and everything that's going on and what it provides to the community. So please keep it up.
Thank you. And the other thing, there were so many things that were addressed here today in an effort to address many of the citizen concerns, not all of them, but I forgot to mention the noise one, too, and the road, that new condition 1.0 that should address some of the noise that was anticipated by that road that will now be for emergency vehicles only. Any other comments? All in favor of the motion, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you very much, everyone. Is there any additional business to come before the planning board today, Mr. Hunt?
Madam Chair, that's all we have for you today.
Planning board is adjourned. Thank you.